Hello, I'm Samia, and today I'm coloring up your day with this presentation about basic color terms. In this presentation, I'm summarizing the book cited below. It's Basic Color Terms by Brent Berlin and Paul Kay, who are famous for this book, which is also very important in the field. Today I'm talking first about the basic data about the survey the researchers performed. Then I will give you the definition about what actually basic color terms are. Then I will tell you how those basic color terms were explored by the researchers. I will give you some language examples. And finally, I will give you some possible explanations about the findings. The question was, are there universal color terms? So for instance, like we have a concept for the color red, but does it hold for all languages? Or are there even languages who have other colors that we are actually not using or something like that? For this, native speakers of 20 languages were surveyed, and the data was compared with written data of 78 other languages. And what the researchers found were those 11 categories: white, black, red, green, yellow, blue, brown, purple, pink, orange, and gray. And the survey basically consisted of classifying colors, so saying for different colors to which category they belong. So, what are basic color terms? The first criteria is that they are not supposed to be partial expressions, so that's supposed to mean blue-green, and that's supposed to be yellowish. And they are derived from other color terms, so they are not basic color terms, they are not primary terms. Then they should not be part of another term. In English we have scarlet or crimson, which you can also say red too. So they are part of another term, and so they are not basic. Then they are not supposed to be restricted to any object class. For example, blonde, it only works for hair and for fur, but it doesn't work for like lemon or something. It only works for fur, so it only works for an object class, and therefore it's not a basic color term. Then it should have a stable reference. Here, for example, the color of rust. It depends on what actually is rusting there. So it can be like brown, it can be like green or something. So it really depends on whatever is rusting. Then if there are some color terms which are not clear regarding the main criteria, then some further criteria can be used. For instance, the distribution potential or the linguistic properties. That means if you are asking native speakers to give you some color terms, then the first things they say will be something like red, green, black, and so on. And maybe at the end they will give you a color like peach, and there may be other native speakers who say, well, peach is not a color to them, it's a fruit. So it has to be some agreement among native speakers as well. Then the question is it the name of an object? For instance, in English there's orange, which is also the name of an object, but orange is fine regarding the main criteria, so it's not a problem. And then the other question is it a foreign or alien word? In the survey, they were asking native speakers. I don't have a picture of it here, so just imagine you have a huge rectangle sheet of paper with some smaller rectangles on it, and on the x-axis they change their tint, so from red to yellow, green, blue, and so on. And to the top, they become brighter. Each chip has its own color, and to the lower side, they are becoming darker until they are black at the bottom. So, and with this sheet of different color examples, the native speakers were asked for each color chip, which color they would name it, and also the question if it is a good example. So, for instance, you can have a green which has a huge shade of blue or a huge shade of yellow, and then you would say, well, basically it's green, but it's not a good example of what green is. So, this would be basically the sheet with the colors. And what you can see here is the foci, so like the center points of what the native speakers said where the color was. So as you can notice here, for instance, here in green there are 19 dots, so 20 language and native speakers of 20 different languages were surveyed, but there are only foci of nine. There are only 19 green foci, and for pink and orange there are only 11. And that's because not all of those 20 languages have a concept of green or a concept of pink. And what you also can notice is that those foci are very widespread among the languages. So for one it's here and for another here, so that's a huge distance. But the researchers were also asking different speakers from one language called Tzeltal, so it's the Maya language, and so they noticed the differences of the foci reported by speakers from the same language were greater than between different languages. So what you can see here as differences between the foci, they are actually based on individual differences and not on differences between the languages. Oh, and you also may notice that here for pink there are 13 foci reported and here there are 11. So don't ask me about this. It's just how it was in the book. So, and what the researchers also notice, it's what I show you in this table. If you have a language which has two color terms, that actually occurs, then those two color terms are white and black. If you have a language with three basic color terms, then those three terms are white, black, and red. If you have a language with four basic color terms, then the fourth is either green or yellow, and with fifth, then it's both of them, and so on, until those last four colors, they occurred in different combinations among the languages. So that's what the researchers found. And so based on this, they made up this theory that there's an evolution about how color terms enter a language. So they say humanity or a language started out with white and black, and this one shows how languages evolved, how basic color terms entered an existing language. So, and based on what they found, they defined several stages. I give you some examples for this. This is stage one. It belongs, their languages belong to, which only have white and black. And I also gave you here a little rainbow, because if you have languages that have not all of our color terms, then they will also report less colors for the rainbow. And as you also can notice here, that the area of what white is much greater than in our language, like in English it would be. So everything that is a bright color, like yellow or a bright green or a bright blue, they would all be called white. And so everything that is dark is then named with black. And one example for this, please don't cite me on the pronunciation. Yale from Papua New Guinea. It knows, they know only black and white, and it depends on the brightness of an object. And they also have some more color terms for specific objects, like red earth or a green of a plant to color yarn or something. And for the color of blood, they say it's black. Stage two, you see that red entered the language, and red takes a really large area, so it also contains orange and yellow, and contrary, black and white now cover much less area. One example is Ndembu from Benue, Congo. To blue clothing they say black, to yellow and to orange they say red. And they have a color term for green, but it is a phrase which means something like water of sweet potato leaves. So it's a phrase and thus no basic color term. Then, depending on whether the fourth term in a language is green or yellow, the researchers defined stage 3A and 3B. 3A is where green entered the language. So, and you also can see it's taking a wide area. One example, One example is Somali from a language from Africa, Southeast Chad. They have ambiguous data from two other researchers. One reported a word for yellow, and the other one reported for this word that its meaning is actually an animal, and he gave another word for yellow, but this was a noun and no adjective. So, as you can see, there's sometimes doubt about whether this theory holds. And so in this case, the researchers just classified it as 3A because there's no clear evidence that it's not. And in those language, blue means something like black whiteness, and brown is derived from green. Stage 3B, where the next entering color is yellow and not green. One example is ancient Greek, so Homeric. And so you see they are also in Europe, they have not been all color terms all the time. And so snow, water, sun and metallic surfaces are called white. The color of ice and grass and olives, they are all called black. And blood, copper and wine are called red. And to green and yellow and young leaves, honey and scent, they are called yellow. Then stage 4, where they are both yellow and green in the language. One example is Tzeltal from Central America, a Maya language. There the question is if those language is transitioning to stage 5, because well, as you can see here, this is the area of green. There's also, it also covers the area of what blue is for us, and the focus is either reported in green or in blue, which depends on the native speaker. And sometimes, and so for the other part, they use compositor. And there was also one speaker who was calling this area azul. So the Spanish, if I pronounce it correctly, so it's a Spanish word from blue, because he had much contact with Spanish speakers. So in several years or hundreds of years, if the word azul, because of contact with Spanish speakers, spreads and becomes a constant in among native speakers, then maybe Tzeltal will be stage 5 one day. Here is stage 5. The next stage contains blue. One example is Mandarin from North China. It maybe contains a word for gray, but it means ashes, and so it's maybe not a primary term. And the surveyed speaker is a native speaker of Taiwanese, and so they cannot be sure if it's correctly what he said, and so they the researchers classified it as stage 5. Then we have stage 6. The new color is brown. One example is Javanese from Sumatra. They have some lean words like biro, whatever it's spoken. It's taken from the English blue, and also chocolate, which means brown and comes from the English chocolate, and was just loaned recently. And they show the tendency to confuse green and blue with each other. So to a bluish gray, they might say dark green. And finally, stadium 7, where there are all those there might be one or more of those 4 new color terms, so pink, purple, brown and orange. Well, this is not very exciting. This is what most Western languages are. So German and English, they have all 11 color terms. Then some explanation attempts. As you might can imagine, there's some trapezoid for linguistic vocals to see how they are related, and they say it is said that the children, they start with the brightest and the lowest vocal, and then the others appear after one after another between them. So one explanation similar to that is that white and black are entering first because they are delimiting the spectrum, and then the colors in between appear. But, well, that's not much of an explanation, and that's all that is a similarity to the vowels. Then there's the theory that the order of their appearance could be based on decreasing wavelengths, but it's also it's only limited. So it only is true for some of the languages, but for many it's not. Then it could be an indication on the development of color vision. So the theory is that people who don't have those basic color terms might not be able to see all those colors. But contrary to that, there were some researchers visiting a tribe where they had one term for green and blue, and they were teaching the people to differentiate, to learn the English terms for green and blue so they could differentiate that. But they didn't find it useful, and they were making fun about the researchers who need those two color terms for those colors who are the same to them. So why do they need so many color terms? So the people are actually able to differentiate between the colors. They just don't have dedicated terms for them. And another explanation, another theory was that societies who live near the equator rather are focusing on brightness, and near the where there is it's a huge difference between day and night, while at the near North Pole and South Pole they rather for long time it's the brightness is the same, so they are focusing more on the color, but it's also does not hold. So what there seemed to be the most likely explanation is that in the industrial society we have all those artificial colors, and we need more terms to talk about different colors. So it's maybe just that we need to use different colors. So thank you for your attention.